Yeah, so I'm here at the Allen Institute, which incidentally is not the same Allen Institute that Ye-Yin Choi talked about. We're both started by Paul Allen, but we're the Allen Institute for brain science. We face each other. We are in view of each other, but we're independent institute. So we focus on biology, and over the. At the Allen Institute, we carry out these very large-scale foundational surveys of the anatomical, genomic, and physiological architectures of brains. In particular, we focus on the brains of mice, of monkeys, and on human. And all this data is published in high-impact journals and made freely and publicly accessible. So the point I'm trying to make here is that these massive resources reveal brains made out of amazing complexity, none of which is reflected in any machine learning models or in any of the current models of AI. What this reveals, including the connectomes that we are now getting, both the complete connectomes of cubic millimeters of tissue, both in the mouse and in the humans, they reveal that these brains are not only made out of millions or billions of neurons and glia cells, not just excitatory and inhibitory cells, but a fantastic, just a mind-blowing variety of cell types on the order of, now we estimate 1,000 different cell types, neuronal cell types, that differ by their developmental origin, that differ by the genes they express, the layer in which their cell bodies is located, which is critical to understand anything in cortex, the addresses they send the information to, that differ in the synaptic architecture, in the dendritic trees, in the electrophysiological functions, etc. So we have, you know, highly heterogeneous individual components, roughly 1,000 times, that combine both the functionality of computation and memory, so very different than our current, you know, VLSI hardware, into these densely interwoven networks with fan in and fan out on the order of 10,000. All right, so this really exceeds anything that science has ever studied, with these highly heterogeneous components on the order of 1,000, with connectivity on the order of 10,000. You know, as I say, the brain is the most highly organized piece of active matter in the known universe. And if I look at the state of the art, you know, deep neural networks, they're really very impoverished, and they're very impoverished. So by and large, they have, you know, halfway rectified or, you know, gain control saturating units. So two or three different types compared to 1,000 different types that we see in the brain. And of course, as Doris also emphasized, the vast majority of them are essentially feed forward with maybe some weak feedback. In the brain, with the possible exception of the retina, there's nothing that isn't massively feedback, not only weakly modulated, but massive feedback. And so understanding brains and their pathologies is a project probably that's going to take us a century or two. We believe now it looks like, if you look at pathologies like neurological diseases or psychiatric diseases, they're very often pathologies of individual cell types. And so that's why the sensors of these different cell types in across all mammals, because it turns out they're very similar, whether you're looking in a mouse, a human, or a monkey cortex, you can identify sometimes one-to-one matching cell types in the mouse, in the monkey, and in the human. So understanding brains and their pathology is going to take a very long time, much longer than the time scale that AI in the industry is operating under. And this is illusion of the, you know, we have this exponential growth in neuroscience data, but that really obscures the underlying sublinear growth in our understanding of the principles of brain science. I'm not talking about cognitive science. I'm not talking about developmental psychology or psychology in general. I'm really talking about the physical substance of our minds, i.e. the brain. And the dirty secret of my field is, that we don't like to talk about, we have a connector, we have a complete wiring diagram of C. elegans since 1986, okay? That's a third of a century. There's still no general purpose integrated model of its 302 neurons, right? And here we're trying to understand the 16 billion neurons that make up the human brain. So look, so I think it's a mistake to look for inspiration, and so here I differ from my immediate predecessor Adam, to look at the mechanistic substrate of the mind, the brain, to help speed up AI. I think that's a mistake. Because the constraint that biology had to operate under, metabolic constraint, developmental constraint, evolutionary constraint, it's just radically different from the constraints that an engineered artifact operates under. Sure. And we don't really understand the relationship. If I look at across species now, we don't really understand the relationship of intelligence. You know, how does it change? How intelligent is something? Because we don't have a good definition that only has 302 neurons, like a C. elegans, but that's been around for several hundred million years, compared to the intelligence of a bee that has a million neurons, compared to the intelligence of a mouse that has 100 million neurons, compared to the intelligence of Homo sapiens that, you know, has on the order of 100 billion neurons. Or even if we look within a single species, like humans or dogs or mouse, it has been done in these species, trying to ascertain some measure of intelligence, like the generalized G factor or IQ factor, things like that, and how that changes across variability in number of neurons, mass of the brain, thickness of cortex. We don't really understand that at all. And so there are these weird puzzles that Neanderthal had a bigger brain than we had, but we were supposedly their superior, you know, we survived and they didn't. If I look at the brain of pilot whales, their cortex, not just the entire brain, but their cortex is twice as large as our cortex. They have 37 billion cortical neurons compared to our 16 billion cortical neurons. So why are we the dominant species and not these pilot whales? So I think we need to look towards psychology and cognitive science and developmental psychology for inspiration that'll help further power. Brains primarily provide existence proof that adaptive intelligence is possible in physical hardware.
Thank you very much for that.